So I'm George McCarthy, better known as Mac. I'm the president of the Lincoln Institute. So we're here to talk about a topic that we're actually quite passionate about called the land value capture. And we're passionate about it for a bunch of reasons, but most decidedly because it brings us back to our roots with a guy named Henry George. And if you don't know Henry George, and I'm sorry if you've heard this before from me, Henry George was a polemicist. He was a political economy writer and a progressive, writing in the late 19th century, trying to reconcile two things: the benefits and the economic growth that was occasioned by the Industrial Revolution, and the ongoing and unrelenting poverty that was still seemingly unstoppable, particularly in cities around the U.S. and the rest of the Western world. And in trying to reconcile those two things, he did a political economy analysis, and he concluded that the reason that poverty persisted in an era of such abundance was a distribution problem. And the distribution problem was that too many of the benefits of economic growth were being given to idle landowners who asserted just that didn't deserve the increased value of their land, because the land was increasing as a result of things that were well beyond the actions of the landowners. So he proposed this single tax, the land tax, that would both help us to completely eradicate poverty, but also to fund the public sector. And he wrote this up in a book that was the second most widely published book in the 19th century after the Bible, called Progress and Poverty, which I think was translated into about 32 different languages and read all around the world. And he made barnstorming tours around the United States talking about this in front of groups of thousands of people. And I don't think he even had amplification, so he must have had a loud voice to be able to talk to that many people at the same time. Maybe like me, right? I could probably do it if I've called upon. So I think one of you might need to mute there on the remote. Thanks. Even though people can probably hear me over the background noise. So anyway, land value capture is something we're passionate about, and because we're passionate about it, it very often makes it difficult for us to communicate well. Because you don't communicate well about things you really, really care about, and you tend to obsess about aspects of it that don't necessarily kind of get conveyed well to others who are listening to it for the first time. And so I thought what I'd do is I try to break through that a little bit and also tell you about how we're thinking at the Lincoln Institute about doing a better job of communicating about, you know, complex things like value capture by just running you through an example, right? So one of the things about land value capture that makes it hard to communicate is that not only are we passionate about it, but it evokes strong emotions from people listening to it. Even some of the words like capture, nobody likes that word very much, right? And so one of the things that you learn in Communications 101 is that once you've raised emotions, communications becomes far more difficult. And the other thing you learn is that you cannot confront an emotional position with facts. And this is one of the things that I think we've learned also from the recent election, that confronting emotional positions with facts is generally not a winning proposition, right? So that's one thing. And so the minute we bring this up, we create an emotionally charged environment, and then we start to follow with facts. It's something that's not probably a good thing. And then, you know, we tend first to kind of describe value capture in a kind of a moralistic, normative, philosophical frame as opposed to a more practical frame. And so I'll give you a little quiz, right? So if demographic changes in a city, let's say natural population increase or in-migration, leads to the increase in the value of land, do you think that increased value is something that the idle landowner deserves? Yes, no, how about raise your hand. Does an idle landowner who benefits greatly from in-migration of people or from just natural demographic changes in a city, do they deserve the increased value of their land, or does it belong to somebody else? Yes or no. Just yes or no. Yes, do they deserve the increased value of their land?
Yes. All of it?
What are you, all socialists here? What the heck? There's only three of you who believe they deserve it. Are you just trying to play to the crowd? Come on. I mean, because in a place like Massachusetts where people really, really care about property values, you say, yeah, damn it, it's my land. Whatever the value of land is, it's my. This is my money. I bought it. Sometimes you buy in order to get the increase in value. All right. So number two. So a city makes designates a new redevelopment area and changes the zoning rules in that area, allowing people to build more densely in the area, which raises the value of the land. Does the landowner deserve that value, or should that value go someplace else? So how many people think if the city rezones and allows you, like let's say they rezoned Brattle Street and allowed us to put multifamily housing in these lots, right? Would that be something that the landowner would be able to benefit from solely, or should somebody else get some benefit from that? All right, how many people think the landowner should benefit solely from a change in zoning and other kinds of land use regulations?
Depends on how many contributions to their campaigns you
make. Yeah, I see it.
It actually depends on if in a downzoning, the property owner then benefits.
Or if in a downzoning they get paid for the value loss, right? Okay. All right, so here's a final question, right? So now, if the public sector invests in land improvements, infrastructure that makes the land more valuable, like, I don't know, adding sidewalks or adding water and sewer to a place that didn't have water and sewer before, putting in roads, right, that increases the value of the land, does the landowner deserve that increased value? And if not, who should get the increased value? Who's responsible for the value increasing in that case? Well, the public sector investment, right? And so so these are three kind of philosophical cases we put out all the time. We say, when the public sector invests in land improvements, somebody should be paying the public sector from the increased value of land. What do we call that? We call that land value capture, right? And as it turns out, I mean, if you are a good focus group, and I don't think you are, because you're not being honest, because if only three people thought that you deserve the benefits of increased population growth, I don't really believe I'm really talking to kind of a land-based audience here. So, but anyway, this is a normative area, right? Who deserves something is a normative consideration, is not kind of an economic issue so much. It's not really even an issue of efficiency, unless you care about the relative efficiency of the public sector versus the private sector. But in every one of those cases, Henry George would say, the landowner deserves nothing, and we should take it all away. The Lincoln Institute of Land Policy, because we're more moderate than that, would say, we should at least get some of the upside of the land value as a result of these changes. And then there's others who would you know, argue about not anything being able to be taken from the landowner. But this is why it evokes passions, and when we evoke passions, the discussion gets very kind of cloudy, right? So we decided that we're not gonna do what I just did with you, which is to get into some abstract discussion about norms and what just deserves. But instead, we wanted to talk to people now, and we go to different places about land value capture by noting to them that they're already doing it. And as it turns out, this often comes as a surprise to places that we go to, that that land value capture is actually a practice that's done pretty prominently in most of these places, but it just takes different names. So for example, inclusionary zoning. How many of you have heard of inclusionary zoning, right? Mm-hmm. Inclusionary zoning is a form of land value capture where you're forcing a developer to produce below market rate units, whether they're below market rate rental units or below market rate owner occupied units, in order to have the right to develop a certain parcel of land. And presumably, the value that they've given up is captured as a result of the state's willingness to allow them to do that development. Or linkage fees, right? You know what a linkage fee is? Where you ask a developer to pay to be what? Linked up to infrastructure to be connected to the public sector. Or a density bonus, where someone says, you know, I'd rather build 100 units of multifamily dwellings in this site rather than the 50 that I'm allowed by right. what's it going to cost, right? And the density bonus might be a negotiated thing where you say, well, we'll allow you to build 100 units if you build a park over here, and then you donate some other land someplace else that can be used to develop affordable housing. And that would be kind of an ad hoc mechanism in which we would actually recover some of the value. Or a special assessment. Special assessment where you say to somebody, look, you just benefited from something we did, and we're going to assess an additional property tax to you as a result of that change. I know there was a big dispute that was on Fairweather here in Cambridge just a couple months ago, where they decided to, they were putting a new infrastructure, they dug up the sidewalks, and they were putting sidewalks back, and the city just decided to put asphalt sidewalks back, and the people who lived on Fairweather wanted brick. So the city said, okay, we'll do brick, but we're going to have to assign you a special assessment. And the people said, fine, or at least the people who came to the meeting said, fine. And then all the rest of the people in Fairweather got a tax bill for $5,000 per homeowner for the length of, for each lot size for the brick sidewalks in front of their house. And that, of course, evoked a response, as you can expect, for the people who weren't at the meeting, didn't vote to get the special assessment, but actually got to enjoy that special assessment. Land value capture is, in some ways, simple when you start talking about the things we're already doing, and in some ways, it's complicated because it intrudes into many, many other areas as soon as you start talking about it. So, for example, it intrudes very quickly into constitutional law. Because in constitutional law, we actually define things like property rights, and we define what it is you acquire when you acquire property. You acquire the right to do certain things on that property, and then you have to ask the state for other rights, right? And when people, think about property rights, especially in a place like the U.S. and especially in a place like Massachusetts, you also think very carefully about when does the state have a legitimate claim to take things away from you that you already own by right. So we have things like eminent domain, but then we make rules around eminent domain where somebody that takes your property has to give you fair value in exchange. And then, of course, then you get to negotiate what fair value is for whatever was taken from you. But the idea is, of course, somebody has to get clarity at the constitutional level. And unfortunately, in a place like the United States, we don't just have the national constitution, we have 50 state constitutions that all define property rights slightly differently and define the right of the state vis-a-vis takings very differently as well. And so right there, you're into a very kind of nuanced and weedy discussion about what's possible. And as soon as you start talking about value capture, all of a sudden the lawyers enter the room, and now you're going to be in for a long discussion, right? But it also runs into local regulations as well. Like zoning, and in Massachusetts, home rule, right? The ability of a local place to define how their property is going to be used and developed and how we're going to be able to tax people on that property. We then need to kind of get to some kinds of definitions locally about how we're going to be able to do this and what the local government is allowed to do vis-a-vis defining rights, conveying rights to people to do things like zoning or taking things away, like capturing the value of the property as a result of something that the public sector did. And then, there's the question about the tools, the actual tools you use to recover this value. What are they? How do you define them? And then when are they legitimate? When are they not legitimate? So as it turns out, the discussion can get to be very deep into the weeds, very confusing, and consequently, we end up with a lot of emotion and often not a lot of clarity, right? We say sometimes more heat than light or smoke than light, right? So like I said, we're here to bring light and not heat or smoke. And so today we're going to talk with three experts about land value capture, mostly in the form of inclusionary housing. And so we have two people with us virtually because they're victims of the blizzard. They were trying to fly in from California, but instead they got to get up early and work with us to set up a video link to be able to work with us. And that is David Rosen and Nora Lake Brown. They're two principals from DRA Associates, which is a consulting firm in the Bay Area that is also a kind of a leading global expert on property redevelopment, affordable housing, inclusionary zoning, and other forms of land value capture. David and Nora have consulted with hundreds of local jurisdictions, states, national governments, about how to do affordable housing right and how to use things like value capture right. And then we have David Bryan Glascock from the city of Boston. I think what we say from the agency formerly known as the Boston Redevelopment Authority, and is now known as the Boston Planning and Development Agency, BPDA. And David is a senior advisor for regulatory reform where he's focused on Boston's zoning code and current planning initiatives. And we should mention this is all happening in the context of Imagine 2030, which is, 14 years from now, the blueprint for growth being developed under Mayor Walsh in Boston. So David and Nora will first present. They have a deck to go through, and hopefully our audio link will work very well. And then we'll turn to Bryan, and then after that, we're going to have a quick discussion between the three of them and me, and we'll open it up to, hopefully, a good discussion with you that is not overly emotional, okay? So keep your emotions in check. Thank you very much. And David, can you hear us and take it away?
Thank you so much. Nora, I think you should mute if you haven't. There's some feedback otherwise. Well, it's a pleasure to be with you virtually. We're both, Nora and I, are really sorry that weather intervened. This is, I guess, falls under the category of best lit plans of men. Bryan, I'm pleased to see that you were formerly, with the agency formerly known as, I don't know if that's akin to the artist formerly known as Prince, but, and we hope that you are able to dig out from the effects of the storm. You have on your screen the title page of today's presentation that Nora and I will walk you through. This approach to analyzing and assisting United States municipalities in exploring, developing, and adopting inclusionary housing programs has been tested by DRA over more than 30 years of practice. We've advised more than 60 jurisdictions on the successful adoption of both inclusionary housing provisions and Mac alluded in his introduction to development impact fees for affordable housing as well, or so-called nexus fees. So what we're going to do here is focus the definition of value capture on inclusionary housing. We're going to define key elements of an inclusionary housing policy, and then we're going to detail for you our analytic approach to assisting jurisdictions and coalitions of stakeholder interests in working through some of the very thorny issues that Mac alluded to in his introduction. One of the hallmarks of DRA's work is that in addition to our policy advisory work, we are real estate and development financial advisors and have worked on about $9 billion of development finance and housing in the firm's history, representing both public and private sector parties, mostly in the context of public-private financing partnerships. So that transactional track record conveys legitimacy to the economic analysis we apply, and that Nora in particular will detail in this presentation today. So Mac outlined a definition of value capture broadly. Interestingly, Mac started by alluding to the effect of market changes, population growth, increases in demand and associated increase in real estate market values as one question about our owners, quote, entitled, unquote, to a gain or to all of that increased value. You'll notice in this slide we don't address that issue. I will say that rising values in real estate assessment are key to another strategy which we employ often with tax increment financing. We might want to discuss that in the Q&A. But here we're focused on increases in land value conveyed by either public infrastructure investments ranging from the modest sidewalks and lighting to the massive, such as a public transit. Has anybody been on the new Second Avenue subway line in New York City yet?
No.
My understanding is that public investment in transit came in at the cost of $1.7 billion per kilometer. So some of these public infrastructure investments are quite massive. Secondly, zoning incentives and entitlements can convey value to landowners. At an economic level, that's undeniable. And we're prepared to engage in the legal debate discussion as well. We are quite experienced in advising our clients on the legality of these provisions, and in fact, are often retained as expert witnesses. So, inclusionary zoning is a form of land value capture, in our opinion, because it seeks to capture a portion of value conveyed that can be quantified, and Nora will go into this in quite some detail, from a zoning action or from incentives or entitlements that are conveyed to a real estate development, to a real estate landowner. The legal basis for this is pretty well established in U.S. law through a long series of litigation under the police power to promote the general welfare. And in a recent court case in which we played a role as expert witness, the City of San Jose versus the California Building Industry Association, the California Supreme Court wrote a landmark decision reaffirming the police powers of municipalities to zone land to promote the general welfare, specifically for the purpose of promoting affordable housing. And that decision was ratified in the form of letting it stand by the United States Supreme Court. So what are the key policy or programmatic elements of an inclusionary housing program? The definition, first of all, is rather simple and straightforward. So all new construction or possibly conversion of use, say from rental to condominium or from non-residential to an adaptive reuse residential program use, that there would be either a mandatory or a voluntary obligation on the part of the developer to set aside a certain percentage of those residential units that would otherwise be market rate as affordable to lower income or moderate income households. So with that as our kind of guiding definition, we would suggest the following key elements are critical to an inclusionary housing program or ordinance. Is it mandatory or voluntary? Voluntary programs are notorious for not producing units or producing very, very few units. The vast majority of programs in the United States and that we advise on are mandatory, either in a specific area, such as a delineated project area, or jurisdiction-wide. The set-asides of affordable units are specified, that is, the percent of the total market rate units that are set-aside as affordable, 10-20%. And generally, these provisions range in the 10-20% range and are a function of the next item here on the slide, income targeting. And income targeting of affordability combined with the definition of affordable housing expense, which we can delve into in the Q&A, are defined by a percent of the area median income. So here in San Francisco in 2017, anybody want to hazard a guess what the San Francisco area median income is for a family of four?
$70,000.
$100,000.
I think I heard 70 and 80 and 100,000, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's $109,000 for a family of four. So a very low income household, defined by HUD standards as 50% of area median income, a very low income household would be one earning $55,000 a year. Definitions of affordable housing expense are a function of the percent of gross before tax household income allocable to renter expense, rent plus utilities, or home rent. Principal interest, taxes, insurance, and HOA dues, and property mortgage insurance, maybe utilities. Another key provision is the term of affordability or resale restrictions, ranging from very short, in our opinion, 10 years, to as long as permanent. The effective date speaks to the grandfathering issue of when projects are subject to the requirement and when they escape the requirement based on effective date, whether these apply to renter housing, owner housing, or both, and if so, how. Many jurisdictions vary the percent set aside and the definition of affordability for renter and owner. the presence or absence of incentives offered by the jurisdiction to lessen the economic effect or impact of the obligation. Nora will talk extensively about that. And alternative compliance options, that is alternative to providing the market rate units on site. It might be off-site new construction, off-site acquisition, rehabilitation, target areas for revitalization, or very common, the payment of an in-lieu fee, that is in lieu of providing the unit. The applicability of the ordinance speaks to its application to new construction, adaptive reuse, or condominium conversion. And thresholds and exclusions speak to often project size. So commonly, ordinances will exempt very small projects under the thinking that it's harder for them to comply, say less than 10 units. Bryan, I think Boston has such an exclusion in its current ordinance. Other exclusions speak to geographic location. Some cities are concerned about the dampening effect on an inclusionary obligation in inner city neighborhoods, where real estate investment is seen as retarded and the jurisdiction is concerned about doing anything which would lessen a real estate investment in these disinvested or disadvantaged areas. And another key element is geographic variation, where development is hot, say in downtown Seattle, Portland, Oregon are examples of this. The requirements might be higher than in outlining neighborhood jurisdictions. And with that, I'm gonna mute my mic, Nora, and ask Nora to take over to really delve into the analytic approach, which we have found so effective in getting to yes with city councils and county boards and commissioners. So Nora, I'm gonna mute my mic and ask you to go from here.
Hello. So the analytic approach that we have developed, as David said, over a number of years of practice, involves the steps outlined on the slide. First, we typically develop residential development prototypes, which reflect usually a range of them that reflect a range of the densities and zoning categories in the local area and the types of products that are being built or planned in that area, from wood frame up to steel frame high rise, because the impacts are often dependent upon the cost, which in turn depends on the construction type. Then we gather market and economic data that enable us to model each of these from a financial feasibility point of view, and that would include rent, sales prices, and a number of other variables. We use that to analyze the feasibility of the prototypes under the assumptions, and then we can use that to do a sensitivity analysis of different set-asides, different income targeting, different incentives that are authorized, and so forth. And then from that, help develop program recommendations. And we may get into this in the Q&A. We have a kind of a public process that we recommend going through to help the locality do this in a public and transparent way. Next slide, please. So again, we're trying to assess the financial feasibility of development under various economic conditions and evaluating that both at 100% market rate or with no program, and then the impact of a program on that under various options. As I mentioned, in terms of the development prototypes, that they should reflect recent and planned developments or proposed developments in the market area. They tend to vary by zoning in terms of density, FAR, land use, lot size, lot coverage, construction type, parking requirements, and the mix of uses. We often apply this to mixed use development as well. Next slide. Other factors, the building efficiency, the ratio of the gross to net square feet, the mix of bedroom sizes and unit bedroom counts, the quality of finishes and amenities, the tenure that's going to be applied to both rental and owner housing. Sometimes we do this under a kind of a low, middle, and high cost area variation, which really reflects differences in rent, sales prices, and land values, different market areas within the community. Vacancies, development costs, land prices, cap rates, and threshold rates of returns to developer need to be kept in mind as well. dimension, this may reflect high, medium, and low cost areas within the region if you have a jurisdiction that's economically diverse. Often communities provide kind of in exchange for imposing these mandatory inclusionary requirements or under a voluntary program, they can be provided as well, in which case the developer would volunteer to create affordable housing in exchange for these development incentives. density bonus, increased density is a major one in terms of providing additional value to the developer to offset the cost of complying with the program. Reducing parking requirements and property tax exemptions or abatements are probably the three most valuable ones that we analyze. In addition, we look at things like unit comparability, which is how the affordable units should compare to the market rate units in terms of bedroom count, the size of the units, the view premiums of the locations within the building and the interior finishes. One example, of course, that got bad press was the corridor option in some of the New York projects where they actually had a separate entrance and a whole separate set of amenities. So you have to be cautious in doing this in terms of what you're setting up.
And then the feasibility assessment really focuses on whether the project is feasible, and that's in terms of its meeting a threshold return, which varies by the financial measure that's used to look at feasibility, and there's different ones, return on equity, return on cost, and land residual analysis, which is the one we'll focus on here, the one we use most often. So the threshold will vary depending on the measure used, the market area, the type of development, and these vary over time as well. So land residual analysis, I mentioned, is one of the most common methods to assess the feasibility. And here you're really looking at the market value of the prototype, typically starting with 100% market rate development. And then you subtract out total development cost of building the prototype, excluding the land. Then you also subtract out a threshold return to the developer, because we know the developers have to be compensated in some respect for building these projects. And that equals the residual land value, which is the kind of the land value indicated for the site based on the assumptions on what's being built there, how much it costs, and what the value is in terms of rents and sales prices. And then this can be compared to current market land prices based on recent sales in the market to determine whether something is considered to be feasible, if it meets or exceeds or is close to current market land sales for that density and that zoning and that location. It would be feasible. If it's well below that or negative, then you're looking at something that's not feasible.
Nora, may I make a comment here on this issue of the comparability to recent trends? As Nora mentioned, land residual value analysis is central to our analytic work and modeling to demonstrate economic and financial feasibility of different types of inclusionary housing requirements, offsets, and incentives. If you think about it for a moment, based on the approach Nora's outlined today, this is a snapshot, right? So we're using, say, current market assumptions, current and projected residential development prototypes, and we're testing feasibility against those prototypes and current market assumptions. So a critical political question is, well, what about different market conditions? Real estate is a cyclical market, to be sure, like the overall economy. And so what we've taken to adding to our analysis on land values in the last maybe 5 years or more is looking at historic trends in cap rates and land sale prices, which is, it turns out to be a fascinating exercise, because if you think about it, when the jurisdiction does nothing, makes no change in zoning, right? How can you account for changes in land price for land which is comparably zoned? Well, the only way to account for those changes is through fluctuations caused by demand and supply, a function which is typically referred to as speculation or investment strategy. So buyers and sellers of land are making bets on the value of that land based on its developability under the current or anticipated zoning, right? So the jurisdiction has done nothing
we would expect to see land prices remain relatively stable. But in fact, that's not what we find. We find extreme volatility in land prices, and this, we've been doing this long enough now, where that land price volatility has become a key factor in political decision-making by city councils and boards of supervisors. Because we help in educating the elected officials to realize that the argument that this is going to depress or adjust land prices rings a little hollow when we see land prices fluctuating by, say, 100% or more within a very short time period. We're talking 12 to 24 months. So we've taken to adding this historic trends of land prices to this analysis as a way to work through the analytic and political discussions.
So as we mentioned in the previous slide, we start with looking at the market value of the developed prototype. So this is a kind of a point-in-time analysis and assumed stabilization of the project. For sale housing, that's pretty straightforward. It's the sum of the sale price of the unit. For rental housing or commercial uses, we start with the gross rent at stabilized occupancy, less vacancy, and less operating costs to come up with the net operating income. And that is capitalized by a capitalization rate to determine the market value of the property. And a cap rate or capitalization rate used in that calculation, again, is the ratio of the net operating income to the sales prices exhibited in recent sales in the market. So these are actually determined in the market, local market, at a point in time based on sales, recent sales, and the ratio of net operating income to the sales price for those sales. And they've been tracked by land use and market area over time. They reflect assessment of risk and future growth potential. So they are cyclical and will vary with economic cycles. And then as David just went into, one of the advantages of using residual land value analysis is you have the outcome of the land value, which can be readily kind of understood by people of all walks who may not be as conversant in return on equity and return on cost and that sort of thing. And it can be compared to market land prices for comparable projects and areas over time. And as David said, tracking these land values can provide a lot of insight into land speculation in the market, into market trends, and into volatility, even when a jurisdiction hasn't done anything that can be provided insight into the program. Oh yes, a couple of case studies. I'll go through these real quickly. I think we're running out of time, but Seattle has a prohibition against mandatory inclusionary zoning. So they use an incentive zoning approach as we described above. Did not find much production that way. Not enough developers were stepping up to the plate. They are able to do sort of a form of mandatory zoning that's implemented as upzoning occurs. So they are going through and upzoning the urban centers and actually plan a citywide upzoning upon completion of an EIR. And then as they upzone, they can impose mandatory inclusionary zoning. And their focus is on an in-lieu fee, and we can get more into this, but when the in-lieu fee is much less than what it actually costs the developer to put a unit on the site, then you're going to get most developers to pay the in-lieu fee. And some communities count on that and are happy with the in-lieu fees. Others really want to provide incentives to create units on site. And then the last slide, Portland is another city that we did analysis for last year. Following legislative action on state basis, permitting mandatory inclusionary zoning for the first time. We went through kind of an open and transparent process using a panel of experts composed of developers and stakeholders in the community to review our assumptions each step of the way, as well as findings. And the result was a mandatory requirement with incentives for trying to get to optional, deeper affordability of units. And these requirements and the incentives offer vary based on the zoning and FAR within different zoning categories throughout the city, because we find that the amount of incentives, the cost of the program, is highly dependent upon the construction type. For example, the high steel frame, high-rise steel frame construction versus wood or podium construction. Thank you.
Thanks, David and Nora. So, all right, so just to kind of locate this in the earlier discussion, inclusionary zoning is a form of land value capture, but when we get into the technicalities of it, you can see very quickly that And it gets a little bit complicated figuring out, for example, well, how many units of inclusionary housing should you expect when you're allowing someone to do a development? How do you figure that out, right? Because one of the big questions in land value capture is, well, what is the change in land value as a result of something like a rezoning or something else? And how can we translate that into something of public good, like affordable housing? And so, as we've seen here, David and Nora have developed mechanisms for actually going through a very deep, detailed analysis of local housing markets to figure out, well, what should we expect to get from this inclusionary zoning? How many units should we expect from a development by development analysis or by a citywide analysis that says, well, this is what we should expect in general? And so I think, like in Portland, in Seattle, where they're doing the rezoning, I think they get to a mandatory inclusionary number of something like 9 or 11% of the units have to be affordable. And they're allowing the developers not necessarily to develop them in the development they're developing them, but to pay a fee and develop them off-site someplace else. But in other places, you might get as high as 20-25%. In San Francisco, they're talking about mandatory inclusionary zoning of 30% of all new developments being affordable housing. And it's a big question of whether or not the economics of housing development will permit that or not. But so now we're going to hear from a local person talking about how the city of Boston kind of uses land value capture to get to other kinds of public goods. So David, take it away.
Thank you. So now you can see the name of our organization, the Boston Planning and Development Agency, BPDA, formerly known as the Boston Redevelopment Authority. So first, let me thank you and Anthony for inviting me here. So Boston, for the past 50 years or so, has been in transition from a working port with lots of military support functions, manufacturing, and a decaying urban core to world leader in life sciences and technology, innovation, and the rebirth of the center city, where we've been gaining population steadily the past 5 years or so, probably between $5 and $6 billion worth of construction permitted annually in the city. And in this kind of environment of change, there's a lot of rent-seeking activity by the development community, as well as sort of place-based entrepreneurs, those landowners that Mac questioned, are they deserving of anything just because they've been there for a long time? But with all this, there's a lot of value-added opportunities for the city here, allowing higher and better uses and through this investment in public infrastructure. But there's also a huge opportunity for value sharing, to leverage the increase in the value to offset our new added costs and to address some of the negative impacts of development. I've been trying to use the term value sharing ever since somebody pointed out to me that it seems like a more accurate description of what we're trying to do, this relationship between developers and local government. Also sounds nicer than capture, doesn't sound quite so violent. Anyway, Boston's been sharing value in a lot of ways over the years, and some of them better than others, and sometimes when we share value it ends up in the papers as not a good thing, so we have to be thoughtful about how we do that. We're now in a phase of citywide planning as well as strategic planning in these changing neighborhoods. The way we've shared value in the past needs to adapt to these new initiatives, and today I'm going to talk about value sharing in the context of affordable housing. But the city also does some serious work in the area of smart utilities, including district heating and cooling, microgrids, interactive roadway design, autonomous vehicles, green infrastructure, high-speed data and telecommunications. We just had a whiteboarding session with a lot of the market players in all of those areas in the utilities and others to think through what the next generation, how we get that infrastructure built out, and who's going to own it, who's going to develop it, who's going to operate it. Our two main tools are inclusionary development policy and linkage. IDP captures projects that are 10 or more units that need zoning relief, provides 13% affordable. In the past year or so, we adopted a new, we updated our IDP, so there are actually three sections of the city, and the formula is slightly different depending on which section you're in, and that's linked to the underlying property values and rents in those neighborhoods. just so you know, you have a sense of the scale of it, IDP has produced about 1,700 plus units have been created. These are deed restricted affordable units out of a variety of percentages of AMI. And we supported another 1,000 units of development. There's another almost 800 that are permitted or in construction right now, and 1,200 more in the pipeline. So this is not an insignificant amount of affordable housing. This is important for the city. The linkage program is a little older, dates back to the Flynn administration, and it is actually, I think David touched on this notion of things being located within the Zoning Enabling Act. This is actually explicitly stated in Boston Zoning Enabling Act, Chapter 665 of the Acts of 1956. Goes into great detail about linkage, and our linkage program is taken verbatim from that. We did it sort of backwards. We adopted linkage, and then we went back and amended the Zoning Enabling Act. But that's another story. Linkage has produced nearly 14,000 units of housing, 12,000 of which are affordable. And the Neighborhood Jobs Trust, you can see the formula there for how much goes to housing and how much goes to job. Last year raised $1.2 million. It served 242 individuals and jobs training. 80% of those folks in that training program completed the training, and 70% will get full-time training-related jobs when it's all over. And out of those jobs, the average wage is almost $15 an hour, which is terrific. And more than 80% will also have access to benefits, which is huge for the city of Boston, because we can't allow development to go forward and not, you know, rise up all the boats. And that's, you know, prior to linkage, that's essentially what was happening. A lot of folks coming from out of town, out of state, benefiting from the development and leaving our Bostonians behind. This is my attempt at mapping it out, but they're sort of the three main ways that we're essentially capturing value, and I use that term really broadly. Residential developments, if it's 10 or more units, right now if a variance is required, then inclusionary development applies. If it's less than 10 units, there's no affordable units required. If no variance is required, then no affordable units are required. But going forward, we have a home rule petition filed with the City Council that would amend, that would go to the state legislature to amend our Zoning Enabling Act, which would allow inclusionary development policy to be formally adopted as a zoning article. The rest of the state has that under 40B, essentially. It's essentially the same thing. Boston Zoning Enabling Act being different doesn't have that. And because it's explicit about linkage and silent on the issue of inclusionary zoning, we're taking the belt and suspenders approach of amending the underlying legislation to allow the city to adopt that as a zoning article. But we've also been working in some of our strategic development areas, strategic planning areas, and building in a density bonus. So you may have heard of the Plan JP Rocks, for instance, a planning area in Jamaica Plain in Roxbury. Density bonuses are part of that, keeping the underlying zoning in place and essentially allowing increased height and density for a much larger contribution to affordable housing. And we have been very thoughtful and appreciate the work that the folks in California have done, David and Nora. We looked at that San Jose case and took a lot of guidance from how that described inclusionary zoning as really as a land use thing and not an exaction. And we've tried to make sure that that's the focus, because ultimately that's what we want. We want diverse neighborhoods, not monocultures of high income market rate housing. We want to maintain the character of these neighborhoods as we rezone them, and one way of doing that is ensuring that there's a mix, a range of housing at different levels, affordable to a different range of people, to try and maintain that diversity. And that was a huge issue in JP. New large commercial projects, this is the linkage piece of it. Again, if it's less than 100,000 square feet of commercial, no linkage is required right now. If it's more and you need a variance or you need zoning commission approval because it's a planned development area, then linkage applies. And you pay at those rates about $10 a square foot. If you don't need a variance or a zoning commission approval, then currently you wouldn't have to contribute to, in linkage, but with the amendment we're proposing to Zoning Enabling Act, we'd add an additional trigger beyond the variance and the zoning commission approval, that if you need Article 80, review and approval, Article 80 applies to large projects over 50,000 square feet, then you would have to participate in linkage. And so we would, again, keep that hook. And then mixed-use developments are about, you base it on the square footage. Each threshold still applies. We also have other examples of value sharing that we've been doing for a long time. Transportation access agreements, a lot of mitigation required there. Parks Commission review, Public Improvements Commission, and the community process. And that's a tough one. The negotiations with the neighbors can sometimes result in community benefits packages that are agreed to. And we're looking very carefully at how those agreements get memorialized and how they get carried out, because we don't want it to be a pay-to-play situation. We really need to have transparency through that process. Finally, this whole presentation was sort of prefaced on the Imagine Boston 2030 and the strategic planning. All this, amending the Zoning Enabling Act is going to be critical as we go through each neighborhood. About half of all long-form building permit applications that are structural changes or changes in use need some sort of zoning relief. And in the future, if we change zoning to match what we want, if we pivot to a form-based code, it's going to mean that we lose that trigger, that hook for inclusionary development and linkage, and we need to pivot to a new sort of hook. And I think, hinging it on, particularly with the inclusionary zoning article, hinging it on as a land use tool that allows us to maintain the character and vibrancy of our neighborhoods is really critical. I'm sure it'll be an emotional discussion, but I think we're well suited to handle that. Great, thank you.
All right, so in the interest of time, I'm just going to ask a couple of quick questions and open it to the floor. Hopefully we'll get an emotional discussion going. But here's how I want you to think about this, because what you've just seen now is one of the challenges of trying to understand value capture, because you get very quickly into kind of the specifics, the weeds, how you do things, right? And part of getting into the weeds is trying to illuminate for people what one should expect from value capture. And so one of the first questions I'll ask David and Bryan are, how do we know that we're getting enough, right? How many units of affordable housing should we expect developers to develop when they're developing, when we give them the right to develop a new 100-unit development? Is 9% enough, or should it be 20%? And how do we actually measure that? And of course, that's part of the tool that David and Nora describe, where they actually go in and do the analysis. What about the linkage fee? Should it be $10.01, or should it be $100? What do we, per square foot? How do we know? And how do we arrive at that number? And this is important because we're going to ask at some point, right? And we have asked in many, many places for the public to approve a mandatory inclusionary zoning regulation. And so, they've been successful in some places, they've been less successful in others. And one of the questions is, how do we talk to the public about what you can get from, value capture, in this case, inclusionary zoning or linkage fees, and what should they expect, right? So we'll start with you, Bryan, and then we'll turn to David and Nora to talk a little bit about that as well.
Well, it's kind of been the $64,000 question for Boston and in our plan JP Rocks. We have some very strong advocates in the neighborhood advocating for very, very high, anywhere from 50 to 100% affordable. And is that possible? I don't think so, because we've looked at the numbers, we've done the pro formas, we've looked at other developments. Really, at the end of the day, all you can do is sort of triangulate on what seems like about right. So Plan JP Rocks is going to have potentially much higher affordability rates than we've done before, and we'll have to see how it plays out. I mean, they say the science of government is the science of experiment. If development doesn't happen because we aim too high, then we have a problem. We've missed out on an opportunity, and new units aren't being developed. If we aim too low, we've left things on the table. Right. So we looked at it. One of the things we looked at was, what's the ratio of low, middle, and high income earners in the neighborhood, and how do we maintain that going forward, that sort of ratio? Because that is really much more linked towards the land use aspects of it than the exaction end of value sharing.
So on the commercial side, how do you figure out what the linkage fee should be? How do you get to $10.01?
That ship sailed back in 1987. And we have the ability every 3 years to look at the consumer price index and adjust the fee accordingly. There's some limits on that. We haven't done that this time around because Boston passed the CPA. And that, I think, is going to open up some new opportunities for us to develop affordable housing and protect open space and some other things. So it may be premature to adjust the linkage fee at this point, but developments happened. No development that I know of has ever failed because of the linkage fee. So we know we didn't aim too high. Did we aim too low? I don't know.
Okay. So I think we would take a slightly different approach to answering this question, Mac, based on our long experience across scores of jurisdictions. I think there are three questions in your one question. Let me try to take them one at a time. So I think rather than describe it as a triangulation, the analytic methodology that Nora briefly overviewed to derive a residual land value for development prototype, given transparent economic assumptions about the project's prototype's feasibility, and alternative packages of set-aside requirements and incentives and alternative compliance options, we're able to be pretty precise in the current market, as I mentioned, about the impact on alternative inclusionary requirements. And Bryan, this would speak to, say, different income targeting levels as well, on the different prototypes. The way that we get to a political answer from that analytic process is by framing the residual land values that result from the analysis Nora summarized against land sale prices in the jurisdiction, both currently and through one or two recent economic cycles. And we tend to find that the impact jurisdictions have political appetite to accept is something in the range of 20% of the change in land value over the last cycle or two. And the reason that seems to be a comfortable range is, I mentioned, we've taken to routinely doing the historical view, and those views typically show 100% valuation changes in land price in a cycle when the jurisdiction is nothing. So city councils, in our experience, have been pretty comfortable with this 20% measure. That then translates, depending upon your income targeting, to the percent set aside max. So if you're targeting at moderate income, area median income, you're going to have a higher percent unit set aside obligation that's feasible. If you're trying to target to, say, extremely low income households at 30% AMI, the percent unit set aside is going to be lower, so there's a bit of a seesaw there. The second part of your question, Mac, is the in-lieu fee. You actually didn't state this, but there was another very important court case, Bryan, in addition to the San Jose case, followed the San Jose decision. And we're pleased to hear your focus on police power, because at our read is that's the current law of the land. Now, that may change with the new Supreme Court, but that's a very important finding for cities like Boston. The other case found that in-lieu fees are not exactions and not subject to reasonable relationship or nexus, but rather they're an alternative compliance option under the police power. The third part of your question, Mac, was how do you set the nexus fee on commercial development? We haven't gone through this methodology in this presentation, but there's a similarly, I would say, precise methodology to measure the impact. And what we're aiming at under pretty clearly established legal standards under Nolan, Dolan, and Kuntz the maximum legally justified fee. My guess is in Boston, for 100,000 square foot Class A office, the maximum legally justifiable fee, Nora, is in the $40 to $60 square foot range. And so what I think San Francisco currently is at $27 a square foot. So we have found no jurisdiction in the country willing to impose at the city council level a fee at the maximum legally justifiable level. So it's always below that. And then the economic impact of that fee is, frankly, Mac, a similar analysis on land value and developer return. And so we will calibrate the fee or advise the jurisdictions about their fee. And my guess is, Bryan, in Boston, your economy could actually afford a substantially higher fee.
And, I don't think so.
Whether politically that's doable. And we actually don't think that CPI is the right adjuster for that. It's better than having no adjuster. But many of our jurisdictions now do a triannual recalibration of the justifiable fee. Pasadena just went through this process, for example. So we actually have a lot of confidence in quantifying the nexus fee, the impact fee, under legal standards and under market and economic feasibility.
Thanks. So we live here in Massachusetts, and Massachusetts actually has an interesting structure. You mentioned it, Bryan, the Proposition 40B. It doesn't really apply to Boston, but it applies to all the other jurisdictions, which local zoning is actually preempted in the case that somebody wants to build affordable housing. And if the local jurisdiction doesn't have a sufficient stock of affordable housing, the state can mandate that someone who wants to build affordable housing can do so in seeming violation of local zoning, right? And so one of the questions I have is, for Bryan, you might talk a little bit about it. I mean, this goes outside your scope of Boston because you didn't really do it, but what's the experience in Massachusetts? And then for David and Nora, there's other states that have also tried these preemptive IZ restrictions. What's your experience been with those? And maybe you can give us maybe an example of one or two. So, Bryan, you want to just tell us a little bit about 40B? Because I know it's a contentious issue here a little bit.
Yeah, well, and it is. And as you say, I mean, in Boston, we're sort of looking at it from afar. And in fact, I'm actually here on a visa today. So I'm for you folks, we're in Cambridge right now. I crossed the river and alarms went off. But you know, we've looked at what other cities and towns are doing in terms of providing affordable housing, and it's sort of a mixed bag. You know, Boston, you know, sometimes we feel a little bit put upon when surrounding communities are not building affordable units. People tend to come to Boston, in search of social services and other support that we provide. We've got a very large homeless population. We've got a fairly large percentage of low-income households trying to eke out a living. And we think we do a really good job at providing support services for those. So when we see other communities sort of not taking up their fair share of supporting low-income families and low-income households, it puts a lot of pressure on us. And I think that's one of the challenges that we've had as we're doing neighborhoods like Plan JP Rocks, which is a mixed income, majority-minority neighborhood in Boston. There's a deep philosophical question of, what happens if we made it all affordable? Are we concentrating people of a certain income group in a certain neighborhood? Do we try and maintain the status quo in terms of the ratio between low, middle, and higher income? Or do we let we could actually maybe generate more total units if we allowed more high income market rate housing to come in and use the inclusionary development policy to generate a lot of lower income units. So this is not an easy right. thing. And a lot of really smart people have a lot of really different opinions about how to go forward.
So David or Nora, what do you have to say about these state level provisions that preempt local zoning to impose inclusionary zoning?
I'm not sure. I'm aware of other states that actually have this preemptive zoning
that allows inclusionary housing to be incorporated or imposed where it's not otherwise. David, are you?
California's density bonus law is a version of that, Bryan, in the sense that it's over the last 20 or 30 years, the density bonus law in California has been successfully strengthened to the point now where if a developer offers to provide certain levels of affordability stipulated in the statute by percent of units and income targeting for affordability, they are both eligible for the bonus and may not be denied their entitlement. So there is a version of that. It's not quite as strong as Massachusetts. I would echo, nor I'm not aware of another state that matches Massachusetts in this regard. But Mac, I thought part of your question, maybe I misheard you, was the types of restrictions that states, legislatures, place on cities adopting inclusionary. Was that part of your question?
No, but you can talk about that as well, because that was going to be my next question.
Well, certainly, yeah, there's the whole range of requirements state by state. For example, in Colorado, as in California, but for different reasons, you're not allowed to regulate the rents on newly constructed housing, so that really preempts the ability to do inclusionary zoning on a rental basis. There's been some talk in California about overturning the Costa-Hawkins Act, which is the basis of that, but that has not happened yet. And in Denver and Colorado, some communities have gotten around that by, instead of the having the inclusionary units be private units, which cannot be regulated, they have them transferred to the housing authority in terms of ownership of those particular units, and then the housing authority can go ahead and set the rents on those. So there are some ways of getting around some of these restrictions, but yes, they do vary state by state. As we mentioned, Seattle, you can't do mandatory inclusionary zoning without some sort of an up zone. So there's a whole bag of restrictions across the country.
Well, and that's kind of why we're, I mentioned one of our neighbors, there's a couple of our neighborhoods are looking at the density bonus thing, because it's sort of a transitional tool as we go to amend the Zoning Enabling Act to actually allow zoning, inclusionary zoning articles. We need a sort of interim tool, and that's the density bonus, because we don't, in theory, we don't have within our Zoning Enabling Act the authority to enact IZA. Mm-hmm. And so it's sort of a pivotal tool, and it's got some challenges for us, because we're also trying to do form-based code at the same time. So we can't say we want a building of X height and then say, oh, and by the way, you can go a little more if you have affordable units. We want to hold people to the X height, X FAR.
Right. So,
Brian, one of the solutions that we've suggested in response to form-based code basis is if you can demonstrate under the adoption of the form-based code that you effectively, I'm using quotes here, upzoned, right? Mm-hmm. So you've conveyed greater value, and therefore the adoption of the form-based code at an upzone basis triggers an ability under an incentive restriction like Washington State's to adopt the requirement for set-asides. So I don't know if that would work. Matt, the other important issue to mention with regard to state authority here is the Dillon Rule, as it restricts the actions of local government in a whole raft of areas, including zoning, and express authority to adopt inclusionary or linkage fees or tax increment or other measures. And there are 39 states in the United States that are Dillon Rule states, where the state legislature really occupies the field. And unless there's explicit authority authorizing localities to do anything in those states, cities and counties do not have that authority. So that's a big issue. 10 states have exempted themselves from Dillon and provide broad powers to municipalities, and 8 states, such as California, Illinois, Tennessee, and others, limit local jurisdictions in some areas of practice, but not others.
So we're a home rule state, but it acts like a Dillon's rule state on a lot of things, and we couldn't put all of our eggs in the basket that anything we do would survive challenge. So that's why we're the belt and suspenders with it, and changing the Enabling Act. And it's a slow process, but we're we're moving forward on it, and we think that, you know, with 20 years of history in this, we're in good shape.
So please, you know, we've just heard that Massachusetts is exceptional. We've always known that, and we also know that that Cambridge is the most exceptional part of Massachusetts. So let's have some exceptional questions from our audience.
Just a quick comment and a question. Massachusetts has a so-called statewide zoning reform bill, which passed the Senate last year, but didn't get all the way through. It's expected, many people think, that will pass in some form this coming year, which includes a statewide inclusionary zoning provision that will supersede every city and town in the state. So something's coming, and so those that don't have it will get this, whether they like it or not. The localities that do have it, the state law, and I don't know if it applies to Boston, will override those of us that already have it. So that's a statewide concern.
David, can you hear that? That Boston?
Yes, I heard that.
Okay, good. Okay, so the question?
Quick question. My own jurisdiction has had inclusionary zoning for about 20 years, and it had the same 10-unit threshold to apply. And for the first 10 years, we were noticing an unusual number of 9-unit buildings getting built.
What are you talking, right?
Something we called the cliff effect. And locally, we managed to devise a way around that seems to be working. But I'm wondering if our consultants have encountered that elsewhere, and what kind of approaches that you've thought about, if it is an issue, to overcome it.
Yeah, we see it all the time, and there are two basic ways to mitigate that. One is to lower or eliminate the threshold, and in the case where the unit count threshold is so low that the project can't mathematically comply with a percent set aside, to require the payment of a calibrated in-lieu fee instead.
Questions?
Yeah, somebody studied the efficiency of this whole set of ideas of inclusionary. Because in essence, what happens is you're placing your need for housing subsidy on the future people who are going to buy or rent the newly developed real estate units, when the value gain, in fact, in a hot real estate market really is falling on everybody who's got property whose value is going up. But if you don't have a transaction tax that forces me, if I'm selling my apartment for $1 million, to, you know, pour in some of my value gain into that subsidy, you're really, you know, how many units do you get? Is it worth it if your city is gentrifying? If you're losing thousands of units to affordability each year from gentrification, and, you know, you're building small numbers of housing units, you know, new ones, because the zoning is so restrictive, and you're getting 20 or 30 units a year, I mean, what are you doing? It's kind of a waste of time.
So that's really two questions, the qualitative and the quantitative. One's about efficiency, and one's about, you know, whether or not it's sufficient, right?
Right. So we ask that question all the time, can we build our way out of this problem? Not completely, but, you know, I think in the last year we had 5,300 units of housing come online. We've seen rents plateau or even dip in some neighborhoods. So we feel like, you know, we have some influence over the market sort of generally. We also know that we have to have that market rate housing being developed in order to help produce the affordable units. And, you know, it gets back to the question that Mac asked and David responded to about, do we have it calibrated right? Is the 13% the right number? And, you know, I think jury's still out on that, but we went through the same exercise that David outlined, and it seems like, you know, in that sensitivity analysis, it seems like that's pretty close to right, and certainly larger developments in key neighborhoods and high-income neighborhoods are going to produce more, you know, and should produce more, because the added value is much greater for them.
Yeah, but in the context of the need in a city like Boston, what are you talking about? subsidy that satisfies 5% of your affordable housing need, 2% what?
Yeah, it's definitely a small percentage, but I mentioned we're producing thousands of units a year. Can we build our way out of it? I don't know. But we're in the sort of the go-go period of doing a lot of development, $5 or $6 billion worth of development every year being permitted. We have to sort of make hay as the sun shines.
So David, I think one of the most extreme examples, if I understand the question, and I'm not sure I heard it entirely correctly, of the relationship between supply, demand, and price of housing is San Francisco. So San Francisco is building historic record numbers of market-rate housing in right now, and has been for the last 3 years, and is projected to do so for the next 3 years. At the same time, both rents and sale prices are accelerating at record rates never seen in the city or state's history before. Can we build our way out of an affordable housing crisis? I would say if we are defining affordable housing crisis in terms of families at 50 or 60% AMI in jurisdictions like Metro Boston, absolutely not. We could add 100,000 units and it wouldn't really change the affordability factors for families at that income level. Where increases in supply affect price and affordability is at the margin. And in a city like San Francisco, that margin is upwards of 200% of area median income. Now, we're talking about families earning $250,000 a year. Ratios of supply, demand, and price are volatile and change by market area. I would characterize Boston, Cambridge as a high price, high cost area, not unlike San Francisco or New York. And so inclusionary housing is not a be-all end-all to meet affordable housing need and demand, but it does provide an increment of affordability that would otherwise not be provided.
My question is about managing over time. I mean, if you're a postdoc in Cambridge and you rent an affordable unit at your current postdoc wages, and then you go to work at Biogen and your wages double or triple, you've taken an affordable unit, right? Mm-hmm. But there's typically not a mechanism, particularly on the purchase side, that you then have to give up the unit. So the larger question is affordable to whom and for how long?
And how do you manage it? How do you steward your stock of affordable housing? So Bryan, why don't you take the first one and maybe we'll throw the other one.
I'll talk about Millennium because I'm going to have to think about the second one a little longer.
Yeah.
Millennium Tower produced a number of affordable units, both on-site and I think some off-site units. And there's a really deep philosophical question about to what extent do you produce on-site units. The Mandarin Oriental development has some affordable units in it, and those are multi-million dollar units. Was that money better spent, capturing, sharing more of that value and producing more units off-site than producing less units on-site? And this gets back to the, forget who mentioned the poor door, maybe it was David that mentioned the poor door, or Nora mentioned the poor door issue. Do we want to have neighborhoods that are monocultures, or do we need to continue to support on-site development even if it means less units? And that's an ongoing question we need to struggle with. But anytime you have big development like a Millennium Tower, it's going to produce some units. The question is, do you do it on site or do you take the money and run and do it off site? And I don't know that there's a great answer to that.
So David, what about stewarding your affordable housing stock over time? How do you get those multi-millionaire Biogen guys to give up their affordable unit after they've gotten it?
Well, on the rental side, we do have mechanisms to allow the unit to cycle back to a new income-eligible household. Those generally are triggered by some percent increase above the income threshold that got them into the rental unit in the first place. Generally, that's a pretty generous income increase, 100% or more even. That's also true in the tax credit world, low-income housing tax credit world. For ownership, the question you raise is really a great question. Nora, I'm not aware of any restricted resale program associated with inclusionary or other, where increases in household income of the original buyer require them to sell and vacate the unit. I think what we tend to see happen is, you know, there is some felt desire, if not pressure, by the occupant to move up, right? So if they got into the home that has a resale restriction on it, they're not going to be able to profit hugely from reselling the unit, right? And now their income is, I think in your example of the question, tripled or quadrupled. You know, their buying power is greatly enhanced. They're probably going to want to get out from under a resale restriction into a market rate unit. So we think there's some natural tendencies for those families to move up, thereby reopening the unit to another income eligible household. But we're not aware of any requirement to make them do so.
So I would guess that would be where the discussion would get really emotional, right? When you say you're going to put somebody out of a house they own, right, because they're now too rich.
No, yeah. I tell you where the discussion gets really emotional. This falls under the category of no good deed goes unpunished, and Bryan should be very sympathetic to this, very familiar with this. So we have income-eligible buyers who go into these affordable, resale-restricted homes who have no hope of affording home ownership in the current market by definition. Immensely grateful for the opportunity to get into the house, and within a year, they're asserting, "Oh, I didn't understand those reset restrictions when I signed that piece of paper, when I made that video tape recording that said that I did understand them." Or, you know, "I'm sorry, I violated the covenant about putting on home equity debt on this property in violation of the city's second mortgage covenants on the unit." So, That's a complaint that we see very, very often.
Yeah, so as we know, these kinds of discussions can get emotional really quickly. But so I think, unfortunately, we'll have to be unemotional about this being the end of our session. Thank you very much for coming out on a cold and snowy day. Hope you enjoy the weekend and the little snow we're going to get afterwards. Thank you, David and Nora, for joining us remotely. Thank you, Bryan, and thanks to Jenna and Will for making this all possible on very short notice. So,